pictures for the moment there.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was great, but I must say, Joe, you look better on the TV screen. I think this is the main political comment, but what we've seen this evening is the consistent strategy that the council has followed over a number of years, and I think we're well versed in what the mayor's been trying to achieve and what the administration's been trying to achieve. So we'll move on to a number of other statements from the chief financial officer.
Okay.
And we'll be covering the estimated collection fund, the statement on robustness and the statement on the adequacy of provisions, and then I'll listen to them.
Can I move that the statement of the chief financial officer on the estimated collection fund out 1780 and the robustness of estimates and the adequacy of provisions as we did in 1819 as set out in the report dated 6/71 of the agenda today be noted and endorsed.
Okay, are there any questions on the statements? Right. All those statements noted and endorsed?
Agreed.
Now we're moving on to item 5, budgets 2018 to 19 to 2019 scope 20.
Can I move the budget recommendations to 1819-20 as attached to the note at Appendix A?
Are there any other speakers?
I was just unclear on the way this has been set out here. I want to speak on the main motion, and I'm assuming we're doing that after the amendment has been done, because otherwise I can speak now. Seek your guidance.
Yes, well, I have an amendment here. I'm just following the note at the moment, and we have the motion in front of us. I think if there are no hands leaping up to speak on the actual motion, then we should move to the amendment.
I do want to speak on the main motion, but normally we do that after the amendment. I'm in your hands.
I think you move the amendment, Councillor. Oh, it's Councillor Cromwell, sorry.
Yes, indeed.
Councillor Tom Cromwell.
Okay, so I speak to you before you second it. Yes, indeed.
Is it seconded?
Lord Mayor, this is the 8th budget setting meeting of the Council since the advent of the Coalition Government and the start of a long campaign of austerity which has seen our budget drastically reduced. In that time, we've seen stringent cuts in most departments which have impacted their services and seen the number of officers and frontline staff reduced significantly. The Green Party has long argued that the elected members should take their share of the pain. Perks such as free parking for councillors and certain expenses seem excessive when the council budget is so stretched. Special responsibility allowances for mayoral leads and committee chairs should also be reviewed for potential savings. In the past, we've also proposed reducing the number of councillors from 90 to 60, which would make a significant saving. Indeed, the mayor did briefly claim he was considering this, but unsurprisingly, he never moved that forward, and indeed, he swelled the cost of elected members with the introduction of the superfluous mayoral leads. A council serious about spreading the impact of the cuts fairly would undertake a serious review of these spending areas. For example, we favour moving away from the mayoral system to a streamlined legal committee system, which could save money. Indeed, this was to form part of our budget amendment, as it had in the past, but for unspecified reasons, this was not allowed this year. Our amendment this year targets three specific areas of spending where savings can be immediately made: scrapping free car parking, scrapping the city magazine and simply act as a mouthpiece for the administration, and reducing the cost of senior management salaries. This combined saving of £300,000 is enough to hire an additional 7 frontline members of staff to respond to the high caseloads currently being experienced in children's services. We appreciate this, the reduction to the council budget dwarfs this figure, but when presented with a straight choice between the expenditure we want to see cut and the additional staff to help the most disadvantaged children in the city, we think it's a moral imperative to agree with this amendment. We note that the council tax will be increased by 5.99% this year, a similar figure to the amount we proposed most years as far back as I can remember. It seems that the Labour group do have an instinct to increase taxation modestly in order to protect vital services. It's just a shame they're only willing to do it and they do not have to ask people for permission. If the Green Amendment had been accepted the first year I was a councillor, and the council tax had risen by 6% in 2015, this council would have received over 17 million in additional revenue over the last 3 years. We accept the need to raise council tax to plug some of the gap in the finances, and therefore not planning to vote against this budget. However, we cannot vote for a budget where the only area for spending that hasn't felt the pain of the cut is the money that councillors spend on themselves. We also question the legitimacy of the process, which has denied us the right to see budget savings from perfectly acceptable in previous years. However, a vote in favour of our amendment would at least show that the councillors in this room can see that they are not uniquely deserving of protection from the cuts. Please support this amendment and show willingness to share the impact.
Second that. Do you wish to second it now? Do you want to, do you wish to speak?
Okay,
so then in which case I'll call Councillor Kemp.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I will address my remarks mainly to the motion, but I will only speak once, so I will dismiss this amendment by saying we will be voting against it, but then we will be voting against the main budget as well. Well, Lord Mayor, I can't begin to tell you how grateful I am that the Mayor has gone on a trip down memory lane. But as you get older, we were reminded that he reached his 60th birthday last time. Perhaps our memory isn't quite as sharp as it used to be. So just let me remind him of a couple of things. He's criticised this administration in our first 3 years of control from 1998 to 2001 for failing to put up council tax. Well, let me just remind him why. 20 years ago, at this equivalent meeting, it was the last budget moved by a Labour leader for 12 years. In fact, the Labour leader was Councillor Prendergast, now the leader of the Independent Group of this council. And that budget, which he introduced, which we tried to amend and then abstained on, actually left us with a council tax as a city that wasn't 20% above the average council tax for the country. It was 20% above the next nearest council. And that's why we had no hesitation in actually bringing council tax down. And let me remind you, Mayor Anderson, that for the first 4 years, the Labour Party didn't introduce an alternative budget and actually didn't vote on the final vote on the budget at all. So you supported what we did. Let me remind you also of a little debate we had at the last council meeting when I thought, just briefly, that you actually understood why we had PFI debts in this council. Well, let me turn you, you won't hear me say this too often, to the very wise words of the Shadow Chancellor, John McDonnell, who laid into the Blair and Brown government
for the way they multiplied tenfold PFI borrowing. That's why we had to take the money in the way that it was given. And let me remind you, Mayor Anderson, you've complained about Parklands and the other PFI schools. The Labour Party in this council chamber voted for every single one of them. Every single one of them. You supported. So the Labour Party in government gave us that way, and you accepted then that that was the right way to give the money. Well, my colleague, Councillor Akinson, will be giving you some details about how much you would have taken if you had had the temerity to vote against our proposals at that time to keep council tax down. So why, for the first time ever in the time that I've been a councillor, this is my 35th budget meeting, will I be voting against the budget today as a whole? Well, we do it for a number of reasons. Firstly, because we have no understanding or confidence in the way that these figures have been drawn up. That doesn't mean to say we think the books don't balance. Of course they do. That doesn't mean to say we're suggesting that this is illegal. Of course this is a legal budget. But what we don't know, because we can't get straight answers from the administration, is precisely how the debts of this council, how the revenue budgets are actually dealt with. And let me give you an example about this. In November, I asked a question of the mayor about the losses that had been incurred on St John's Market. A disastrous reorganisation and redevelopment, which I know, because I find out things that you don't want me to find out, cost this council £1 million in lost revenue. Did I get a straight answer from the mayor to that? Not at all. I didn't get an answer at all. So time after time, when we raise questions, there's an obfuscation and there's a deliberate attempt to deny us. I don't know, for example, I hope my old mayor, as the mayor was allowed to go on for some time, I'll have a little latitude on this. But I don't, if you want to send it to me, I can assure you, Councillor Mayor, we'll report that in our news
letter. Look, everybody has the right to speak in this chamber. You will get your chance to speak your hand up and I'll call you. But Councillor Kemp, the only latitude that I've given is to give, there were no timings set for the mayor to give his presentation. It was with the permission of the council to give that that presentation. I gave latitude to Councillor Hannatty after 26 years of service. But there are rules of debate in terms of speaking at this council, which are more generous than normal in the council meetings. So I'm suggesting that we keep to the rules. I hope you weren't accusing me of trying to silence you or cut you off. The time that I take for speaking will be added on to your time.
That's very kind of you, my lord, but I wasn't criticising you. I was criticising the fact that one group leader is now talking forever and others aren't allowed to. So I can't go through my speech, but let me give you a little tip. www.richardkent.wordpress.com. You'll see my speech in detail, and I've supplied it to the press, although I've clearly not been able to give it. So I just want to respond, lastly, to the question of Everton Football Club. I think I detected from what the mayor said an assurance from him that the final decision, i.e. the final vote, will not be taken by the cabinet, but will be taken by every member of the council in this chamber because it's used as a strategy. And that's exactly what I asked him to do. But I've challenged today the council to release the SITFA report. It is absolutely scandalous that a report can go to the other side of a discussion, of a negotiation. So Everton have seen this report, but not a single member of this council. So there are things in that report, and I do have a reasonable idea of what's in it. that perhaps should not come forward into the general domain, but I have challenged the council today to issue a redacted report so that every member of this council and every member of the public who will have to underwrite a £200 million debt as council taxpayers of this city can actually see it. My Lord Mayor, money has got spent all over the place. I am not allowed to say where that is, but as I say, if you read my log, you can find out. But I did just want to say, finally, my Lord Mayor, we've all been very upset by the news that the Mayor had such a bad Christmas, and that has obviously changed his life. So my grandson couldn't get a Stay Electrics, but we do have a little present for you. Perhaps on the basis of this, you'll go and meet the people who you've sold £1 houses to and destroyed their lives and actually show some humiliation.
Your time is up.
My Lord Mayor, I don't want to dwell on the past because I think we all said something for right, something for wrong in hindsight, something was done for right reasons for a time. But let's go look forward because that's where we're here. We're looking for the city's future. Can I say one thing about the Green speech? I really, my heart sank. Councillors, I think, are grossly undervalued of all parties. I think the role of councillors have become denigrated by public debate, and that actually doesn't do us any good to attract the right people to come to our meetings. And every time the role of councillors is attacked, like we've seen in the last speech, it does local democracy real damage. We have had our allowances frozen since 2010, is fact. I really do find it quite perverse. The Green Party suggests we should spend hundreds of hours processing car park claims to replace free car parks. Really can't think of anything more likely to cause the destruction of more trees needlessly. And I think I'm going to ask you to ask that question earlier. We have 9 councils retired. I'm not wanting to reflect on any of the individual circumstances. The point I'm making is not that. If any business was looking at 10% of their managers leaving in a year, they would be concerned. I'm sure there's some reasons for all of them, but I don't think it helps us to attract and retain good councillors. There have been work Green Party made pots, but somehow councillors are lining their pockets whilst the workforce was suffering. I would say to you, my Lord Mayor, if I can make this point to us, I think our councillors have often picked up some of the work that council officers are doing. But less value, I know as a ward councillor, I'm doing grant forms to get youth working to my ward, with the assistance of my colleague Kevin, who can't make it today, who has struggled having had 2 operations with diabetes, and is still doing charity fundraising, doing some of the work that public services used to do. I really do resent the bureaucrats on councillors. And I hope I speak for all of us. You're undermining local democracy and belittling yourselves as well as the rest of us. If I can now turn to the main points of the agreement. It is difficult for a small government to create budget amendments. And I just want to ask on 2 themes that I have raised before, and I'm trying to do it because I think we need to look forward, not backwards. The Mayor has made quite an articulate case for the need to bring new housing, not just from a jobs point of view, not just from the point of view of actually getting more revenue to the council, but growing the economy to the point as well. Thoughts that we, I think, all have a common consensus on. Can I point out a little example to where that is happening, but I think it's taken far too long, we can learn from it. In my own ward, we have 2 sites that have been subject to compulsory purchase order, and that has taken an incredible long time. It's now come to fruition after 5 years in a way that should take a lot sooner. Clifton Road East, we now have a seed building process successfully that will reduce a wasteland site the council's funded money to clear. It will produce six houses and open employment for a local housing company. What I find so frustrating, it has taken so long to get a wasteland site that was partially owned by the council. The previous administration didn't even know the other part of the site. Sorry. And I'm just saying, I'm sure that's true right across the city. There's lots of small plots which are a burden on us for plenty, a burden on the community safety, that's taking far too long to bring to the housing market. And I'm just begging, whether it's through the new housing company or through neighbourhood service expand their role, we could do more to get rid of these problem sites across the city and actually help them meet that target. I use that just as one example. A classic example that worked well, both Tilmont Hill Playground and Lowndes Road are now producing good quality housing that is meeting our targets by using CPOs. I'm just asking, what can we do to speed up the process? Because I think it's taken far too long. We can all gain from it and achieve the aims that we all have. The other question I'd like to ask the Mayor to explore. I've raised it at the Mayor Committee, I know Stephen Murphy is probably the board who raised it. And I say that with respect. I think there's a real opportunity. If we use 106 monies to fund energy saving in community buildings, whether it's schools, whether it's community centres, we actually reduce our expenditure we're giving to those bodies and actually help save and meet our energy and environment targets. I think there's a real opportunity to do that. I mean, not making clear for the organisation I look after myself, we've actually done it. We've introduced LED lighting and solar panels to reduce our revenue costs, but also as a social statement of wanting as a community charity to be part of a safer environment. I think we actually did that on a programme basis across the city. We could actually reduce some amount of play we do to community groups because we're reducing energy costs, but also meet our social objectives or more than one our environmental objectives. So I'll just raise those 2 points. And my mayor, can I get my lawyer, I'll just finish on this. When can we expect the Green Party to support the local councils doing their work, the degradingness? I think we would all be more grateful.
Thank you, Councillor Tim Bond.
You're such a piece, aren't you? You're both from the your more grand wackiness than the Teenage Fan Club in 1991. Have you been sat in meetings with those residents, talking through their problems, dealing with their issues one by one? Have you been sat in meetings with offices, bringing those problems to those offices and saying, sort this out? Have you achieved anything in that area until you stand up now in a council chamber and tell us all that all of a sudden you've become aware of this amazing thing, the Home to Account Scheme, and you've decided to wade in like the caped crusader and tell us all what a wonderful job the Lib Dems would do? You aspire to leading the city. There is nothing in your track record, nothing in anything I've ever seen in this city that would indicate to me that you're fit for government at any point in the future. You weren't fit in the past, you're not fit now, and you won't be fit again.
See what deciding to stand down as a councillor does for you. Two of the fours, Councillor Beaumont. Councillor Tandrias. Order everybody, please.
Yeah, shut up. Can I just say one minute before I want to say your name here? I'm on board for the Greens amendment. When you move your proposal, my understanding is that you don't want anything to pay for councils to make away. You take away the bus, the car pass, but you're not going to allow them to claim their actual parking figures. As Councillor Radford said, that would cost more than council officers' time and the actual fees and what you're saying. So you're actually saying for someone who lives up in Speak or someone who lives in exactly. Get the bus to town and the time that takes, and I get the bus home, because getting the bus will be cheaper than buying it home. However, it also will be very expensive for the rate, because you don't know how long you're going to be there. So, no, I wouldn't vote for that. I've been with Councillor Radford, who spent years on this council, running down the way that councillors, hard work with councillors too, for the community and the city, and councillors haven't had an increase. These have. Had several of them ask over the same time period, why are councillors any different? We do more, I certainly think they do more work than most MPs. Most MPs seem to go into Parliament to get out of the way of doing the work. Although, I'm going to go back onto something that Councillor Kemp said around the rates and 20% increase. Councillor Kemp, I haven't been honest with you, you're a lot older than me. And by the way, before we get to the bus fares, I've got a bus pass, so it wouldn't cost me anything, by the way. The only thing is, it would take me half an hour waiting for a bus, because you don't wait along the front of the bus coming. And I'm the same when you go along, so it'll take a hell of a lot longer. But it won't cost me anything, because I've got a bus pass. But we go back to the old rate system, the 20% increase. Does Councillor Kemp remember when Sir Jones was leader of the council, and he introduced the rate rebate to all ratepayers, paying a pound it was, and people were absolutely made up that they got this paying a pound back at the end of the year. Unfortunately for the city, your government grants at that time were based on what you spent the previous year. So in giving a rebate back to everybody in the city, we actually cut our base grant the next year. And the following year, I did work with Outbound in about 1996. Up to that time, we'd lost something for even 20 million quid. Well, today's money was a hell of a lot more than them time. And you carry it on through then, the base rate was lost and has been lost for all those years. We also have the poll tax. The poll tax will pay.
Can I just ask Councillor Prendergast to remind
the chamber, because you were the councillor at the time, I wasn't, but I was aware of it, that what it was about was spending pound for pound, and it was matched by central government. And Sir Trevor Jones sent £2.3 million back to the Tory government.
I've got 2 minutes of my speech, so I wasn't going to go into the rough details. I was going to go into the exact details, just a broad outline. Yes, it did cost millions of pounds. But we also have the poll tax, and the poll tax was payable by everybody over the 80s. That's that long ago, I forget that it was 60 or 80. But what I know, that I had two children, myself and my wife in the house,
So we were paying four times whatever the hall tax was. My kids had just left school, they couldn't pay it. But it was a charge against them, criminal offence, taken to court, and all that sort of stuff. So who finished up paying it? So they stayed out of law, out of trouble in court. We had to pay it. When the poll tax was abandoned, we still have to collect the same amount of money to bring in the cost to run the city. And that's been a 20% increase, but because the council tax then became 20% higher than the poll tax for the individual, I actually saved money. Because instead of paying out four sets of poll tax, I was paying out one and a fifth. So for people with children on a poll tax, it wasn't an increase, it was an increase in figures, and you know you're doing time and time again, you make figures say that maybe there was, except Salisbury. But that's what happened. It was a 20% increase because the poll tax was divided amongst all the family. Council tax was paid by the household, and it was a saving. When you save your head as long as you want council, and I can tell you, I completely council. We just quoted the figure from council. We don't go back through the records. We quoted to you time and time again. We also quoted to the fact that at the time, 92% of the properties in